What is up, YouTube? We are back with another video. In this week's video, we are talking about the five reasons why your cuttings have failed this spring and fall, and how I can help you guys improve your cutting success rate and how they can grow exponentially to shade off that neighbor, to hide yourself getting into a blind or a stand. And so stay tuned. So the main question we get asked a lot is, why did my cuttings fail? I laid the ground fabric, I tried to water them when I needed to, and really it comes down to a couple different reasons why we see fails a lot. One of the main reasons cuttings fail is because of deer browse. A lot of customers, you guys plant these in areas where a lot of deer travel, might be next to a food plot, and if you're planting every single shrub or tree besides the silky willow, the deer will browse on them heavily, especially early spring when there's new buds, new shoots coming. You'll see a new shoot starting from the stem, but then there'll be no leaves, no buds apparent on those new cuttings, new stems coming out. And that is because the deer are browsing on those new stems. And so over time, you know, we've gotten some questions, some emails on guys that have little growth in that first year from either a hybrid willow, dapple willow, red orchard dogwood. And they'll say they have limbs, no leaves, no apparent buds, and they're wondering what happened to them. And really, that's because of the deer browse. The deer browse on them kept that cutting to little growth, and now you need to protect it that next year. One way we protect it is by a 6-foot snow fence from U-Line. They have a great heavy-duty 6-foot snow fence. We surround that area, use 7'6" T-posts, and that seems to work very well from keeping the deer out. Now, your cuttings haven't died. Just because the deer browsed on them, the cuttings haven't died. What's awesome is that they have continued to grow a great root base in the ground while the deer have been browsing on those new shoots above. Now, I would not allow the deer to browse on this year because you'll never see growth, and over time, that cutting is just going to keep deteriorating because it's not able to produce new shoots, new buds, and to actually grow into the tree or shrub that it's meant to be. So protect it the second year, now that you've noticed that it has been browsed on, and that cutting is going to explode in growth. It's took its whole first year by creating that root system, that root base. It maybe grew 3 or 4 inches. And now this year, once it starts budding out, it is going to have an exponential growth that you're gonna notice. It's probably gonna grow 4 to 6 feet with a tree, the hybrid willow, hybrid poplar, and the shrubs, you're probably looking 2 to 3 feet, but that's gonna have 6 or 7 different buds. So really protect those trees and shrubs if you find the deer have been browsing on them. The silky willow, we notice in our silky willow lines that the deer throughout the winter time are really browsing on just the outer tips. It's almost like they're just tasting it, but they don't actually browse on them too much where it's actually gonna prevent them from growing. It's only they're nibbling on it, might get a little taste of it, and then they move on to something else like the hybrid willow or the dappled willow, red osier dogwood, stuff like that. So that seems to be one big major fail that happens is deer browse, especially on the red osier dogwood. It's a slower growing cutting, so you really need to think about caging it, protecting it in those areas to be able to get a good stand of red osier started. Once they're started, that root base is going to be expansive. And even if the cuttings and the deer are browsing on those cuttings and the new fresh shoots, it's not going to kill that cutting. And actually, it's going to produce more shoots from either the root base or from the actual main stems that it has started. So it's actually awesome that deer continue to browse on these cuttings because it activates a new shoot to start. And that's what the deer love to browse on. They don't like to browse on those old 2, 3, 4, 5 year old woody stumps. They like those new shoots that are fresh this spring, and they're going to continue to browse on those all throughout the year and into the winter time when it's actually crucial, because there's just not a ton of browse in those areas for deer to eat. Another reason cuttings fail is because of the lack of moisture in the soil. Now, we had 2 springs ago where in the west central Wisconsin area, we did not have very good moisture, spring moisture, not a lot of rain. And I know our nursery took a big hit in growth and also cuttings around the area. I know some of you guys down south that didn't get a lot of rain that year were struggling with the cuttings. Now, this past spring, we have seen exponential growth. due to a great spring moisture in the soil. And one way to combat that is to use ground fabric that we sell on our store. And there's a ton of other different fabrics, but this ground fabric allows moisture to get in close to the cutting and able to hold moisture close to the soil, allowing that soil to not dry out and to keep that cutting moist for that spring and then throughout the dry conditions in the summer and fall. So that's a number one reason why we recommend ground fabric, is to keep that moisture in the soil and to eliminate weed competition, which brings me to my next fail is the weed competition. And you need to eliminate weeds close to this cutting to have success in tree or shrub lines. It's a lot easier to run a rototiller 6 foot wide because you might use 6 foot ground fabric and make one or two passes up and down and then lay the fabric down and plant your cuttings. Now, if you're going to plant in areas that you're just trying to make pockets within, let's just say switchgrass or in swamp areas, using fabric can be pretty difficult. So if you can weed whack or at least mow some of that area that grass is down to allow that cutting to hit at least some sunlight in that early spring and early summer timeline, that's really gonna help them boost and start sprouting and start producing buds and produce that awesome root base. And I know it's a lot more difficult to use fabric in those areas. A lot of times guys will just overplant in those areas because the weed competition is going to obviously keep the success rate lower than if you were to use ground fabric. Now, I would recommend using ground fabric, especially in these tree lines, because you don't want to come back and have to weed close by to monitor them, and you don't want to use any sort of chemical close to these cuttings. And the number one reason why I recommend only using ground fabric and not the spray is because a cutting is an open wound. It's an open wound that's going to absorb any sort of moisture, chemical, or microbiome in that surrounding area. And so we find a lot of times that guys that have sprayed glyphosate continuously and any other herbicide, that it really affects their success in that first year in that cutting, because it's such a vulnerable cutting that's willing to absorb anything and everything in that soil to continue to grow. Now, we have used chemicals on our property in our food plots, but we like to give a buffer of about 10 to 12 feet gap between the cuttings, especially the fresh first year cuttings, and the new food plots that we're spraying. We want to leave that buffer to make sure that if there happens to be any overspray or we get a rain and some washes off, we want to give that buffer so that it's allowing that cutting to not be able to absorb that spray. And you definitely do not want to spray anywhere close to it, especially right before planting. If you do happen to spray in that area and then you happen to plant those cuttings, I would give yourself a little buffer or a window, like 2 to 4 weeks after you spray, to make sure that that spray has been eliminated from the soil, has been neutralized, because you do not want to waste your money on brand new cuttings and then to find out that they just end up failing that first year because that spray is still in the soil and that cutting absorbs it and then dies, unfortunately. And the final reason why some cuttings fail is because of the lack of ground contact made when planting. In a couple of these videos, I'm gonna show one here right now. As you can see from this, we are planting it in the soil, keeping it tight around the cutting. You don't wanna make such a large hole that that cutting is extremely sloppy. You actually wanna have it so that when you push it down, it's making great ground contact all the way surrounding that cutting, because it's going to be able to allow that cutting to absorb the moisture and not dry out. A lot of times we see customers where they've made too big of a hole, didn't backfill it, and that cutting is very sloppy in that hole. And those are the cuttings that end up failing because there is a lack of moisture surrounding that cutting. So you want to create an awesome moist environment for these cuttings. That's where you're going to find great success. High success rates is to plant properly. We have another video I'll probably have right up here on how to plant a cutting. And I suggest watching that because that is a great video explaining the proper depths. With a 12-inch cutting, you're looking at 8 to 9 inches deep with 3 to 4 inches sticking out, probably one or two buds that'll start forming. And then as you get bigger into more, you know, longer cuttings, the 2-footers and then some 6-foot cuttings, they need to be planted a little bit different and a little bit different, obviously, lengths. And I've also talked about advantages and disadvantages of using a 12-incher versus a 24-incher, which I'll probably have that video right up here also. That one is our Red Osier Dogwood, where I explain the differences between the 12-incher and the 24-inch cutting, advantages of both. One of the main reasons why we plant 24-inch cuttings in all of our installs is because it's more budding potential because it is a longer cutting, so it does have more buds per cutting. And also it is able to not dry out as quick, and we're able to tap in a lower moisture because a 24-inch cutting needs to be at about 18 inches deep. So it's going to eliminate the issues with water and moisture in the area and the surrounding, but you need to be able to get it down 18 inches. So we use a rod, it's called a dibble bar, and we have select different sizes that we have made. Rebar is a great option that we've seen tons of customers use, depending on what it is, a quarter inch, a 3/8, stuff like that. As long as you're able to get a hole in the ground that is slightly bigger than the cutting, so when you push that cutting in and then you surround it with that soil, it's going to lock in all that moisture and not dry out the cutting. So these 5 reasons are deer browse, which can be eliminated by using a fence, or if you're using silky willows, you won't have to worry about deer browse unless you're in a high deer traffic area. Number 2 is lack of moisture in the soil, which can be eliminated by using good ground fabric and hitting that spring moisture right on time, getting those cuttings in as soon as you get them in the mail. And number 3, suppressing weeds and eliminating weed competition, which again, using ground fabric is a great way to eliminate weed competition in tree lines and shrub lines. And then number 4 is the use of chemicals to eliminate weed competition. I would definitely stay away from that, especially in tree and shrub lines, to just use the fabric, till, lay the ground cover, and then plant the cuttings. That is the greatest, highest success rate that we have seen so far. And then number 5, just to plant properly, not to have a sloppy cutting, get that thing down 3/4 of the way of that cutting. Watch those other videos on how to plant those properly. I'll probably have a new one coming out soon. Just an update on how to plant properly, a new video to show you guys how we're doing things here on the farm, and then also the customer installations. And I appreciate all support. Like and subscribe as usual. And if you guys have any recommendations for new videos, please leave it in the comments below. I always read those, so I like to see what you guys are saying, to any comments or any future videos you guys want to see. And I appreciate you guys all watching, and we'll see you guys next week.